When you were a kid, you probably had a crazy imagination. I mean, a lot of us did. We could imagine all kinds of things. Things like, what if things in your house could talk? What would they say? I mean, take example, pickles. If pickles could talk, what would they say? Hey, I've been cooped up in this jar for way too long. Wait. No, don't spear me with a fork. Use your fingers. Wait a minute. You're not planning to take a bite out of me, are you? Oh, that's good. Or what if you had a garden that could grow anything? What would it be? Would it be books, ice cream, pizza? I mean, it wouldn't be anything as boring as money because, I mean, that's a grown-up dream. So, you know, we grown-ups seem to have lost a lot of capacity to imagine. But I think God's kingdom invites us to rediscover it. I mean, imagination helps us think about something that hasn't happened yet. And then maybe we can work to make it happen. Imagination, it actually has a lot to do with faith. And the Bible verse that we're going to deal with today, Hebrews 11:1, says, faith shows the reality of what we hope for, and it's the evidence of things we cannot see. We're going to be talking about that in just a few minutes. I hope you can stay with us until then. I'm Jack Starr, and this is the February 21st service of the United Methodist Church in Osceola, Wisconsin. Welcome.
I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lived in me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lived in me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lived in me. Satan had me bound. So glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lived in me.
Amen. And it is good to have you with us wherever you may be online. And we hope you can stay for our message in just a little bit. But right now, let's open our service with these words of an opening, of centering this call to worship. Eternal God, we open our minds and our hearts to you this hour. Turn us toward you and awaken us to your spirit for this time. And even after we have left this place, this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's turn to that song, a great old gospel hymn called Leave It There. Leave It There. It's number 522 in our United Methodist hymnals. But the words are up on the screen. So I invite you to join along as we sing Leave It There.
Hold of its silver and its gold, and you have to get along on meager fare. Just remember in his word how he feeds a little bird. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there, leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust in every doubt, take your burden to the Lord. if your body suffers pain and your health you can't regain and your soul is always sinking in despair. Jesus knows the pain you feel. He can save and he can heal. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. When your enemies assail and your heart begins to fail, don't forget that God in heaven answers prayer. He will make a way for you. He will safely lead you through. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. When your youthful days are done and old age is stealing on and your body bends beneath the weight of care, he will never leave you there. He'll go with you to the end. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there.
Amen. I love the lyrics of that song. Just about everything that you might encounter, everything that puts a burden on you, well, we can bring it to God. And so that's one of the things that we're going to do right now. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and we are invited. I don't know, I think perhaps God's invitation is more than an invitation. I think it's even an imperative, a command, to come to him bringing our concerns, our cares, our burdens, and not just for ourselves, but for everybody, our loved ones, our friends, our neighbors. Well, Jesus even said, our enemies. So if we start with those who ourselves and those we love very dearly and go through the whole spectrum to those who are our enemies, that's pretty inclusive. And so we are invited to pray for everyone. Let's pray for our communities, for our church. I'm going to lead out with some categories. I'll give you a moment to lift up the names of those who are on your own heart. I know that there are a number of those who are in our church fellowship who are struggling with some health issues. I know there are some who have had procedures this week, not just a couple. There are a few who have had procedures and are recovering at this point. And so we give thanks, but we pray for continued recovery. Boy, the prayers that we lift up for one another have power. So let us go to the Lord in prayer now. Our gracious God, thank you for prayer. Thank you for your open invitation for us to come to you anytime, any place. And we thank you, Lord, that we have an opportunity to join our hearts together with loved ones and friends around us. And even though we're not in the same place physically, we can be in the same place spiritually, and we can be with you. And so today, Lord, we do want to lift up our loved ones and friends in our community. We want to pray for all of these who are dear to you as well. Lord, we pray today for all of those who have suffered loss. There are so many, some that we're aware of and so many that we're not. All who have suffered loss. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Lord, we pray for those who have died. Many have passed away because of complications of COVID. and still cancer and heart disease and liver disease and kidney disease and so many other concerns. There are still automobile accidents and other forms of accidents. There are those who have lost their lives because of the deep freeze that has blanketed our country. So many have lost their lives, and so many are grieving the losses. We lift them all up to you. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. We pray for those who are ill. And again, Lord, that is such a big category. Ooh, those who are ill because of all of these different conditions and now exacerbated by COVID-19, we lift them all up to you. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Those, Lord, who are facing uncertainty, and again, it encompasses many. It may be health uncertainty, it may be economic uncertainty, it may be uncertainty in their families or in their relationships. It may be, for some, it is really fraught with concern, and for some, it's looking forward to a hoped-for future. We pray for all facing uncertainty. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. And we pray, Lord, for all who suffer, those who are suffering from drought and from famine, from disease, from hostility and violence in their homelands, those who are suffering from dangerous climatic conditions, whether they're storms or blizzards or there are so many things that assail your people, Lord. We lift those people up to you. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. We pray, Lord, for the leaders around our world. We immediately think of political leaders, leaders of governments, but there are leaders of our communities, leaders in our businesses, leaders of our organizations and institutions, leaders who influence others in their realm. So many people who shape our world, Lord, and affect the lives of so many others. We pray for wisdom and guidance, and we pray for your blessing on those leaders. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Lord, we pray for all those who serve. That includes so many. Thank you, Lord, for those who serve us and serve one another. They are really doing your will. They are doing your business, Lord, when they serve others. We think of those who are police officers and firefighters and EMTs, those who serve in the military. We pray, Lord, for those who serve in our schools in so many different ways, those who serve to keep our cities operating, including plowing streets and sidewalks, those who are serving in the stores, making sure we have the physical, our physical needs cared for. And we pray, Lord, for those who are serving in our medical field. Thank you for them. Protect them. We lift them all up to you. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Finally, Lord, we pray for your church. We pray, Lord, that we will be a church that reflects you. Your church is so diverse around the world, and as different as we may be, we pray, Lord, that your church around the world looks like you to our neighborhoods, to our communities. We pray, Lord, that we will be open to your voice and your call, that we will be listening to you all the time so that we might respond and your grace and glory may be seen through us. Protect your church, Lord. Renew your church. Make us responsible and receptive and reflective of who you are. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Lord, there are so many, even with all these categories, there are probably things that you need, Lord, to fill in, blanks that you need to fill in, because we don't cover everything. We thank you, Lord, that we can come to you, though, Lord, and we can trust you, Lord, and that you invigorate our imaginations and our dreams. You, Lord, pour out your faith on us. You give us that faith. Help us to live into that. We thank you that we are yours, and we pray that you will renew us with your energy and vision, that everyone we encounter, whether it's as individuals or whether it's as a church, that people will see you in us. Let us be disciples, Lord, that share your word and your name. We pray this all in Jesus' name, as we pray the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
You know, it's hard to imagine the word imagine without thinking of John Lennon's song. I mean, just hearing those chords at the beginning of it, those chords on the piano, it draws us right in. Imagine there's no heaven, it's easy if you try, no hell below us, above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today, ha ha. Imagine there's no countries, it isn't hard to do, nothing to kill or die for, no religion to. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You know, if I were playing this or singing it, you might even be singing along with it. We've all heard the song, and we're all touched by it in some level. We're invited to dream along with John Lennon about a future of peace. Now, he leaves out God and Jesus, which I think are fairly important omissions. But there's something thought-provoking about what he's suggesting. With no possessions, with no religion, with no countries, why, there's nothing to kill or die for. We'd all be freed to live in peace. And John Lennon can see that in his imagination. You know, that's faith. Now, it's not a Christian faith, but it's faith. This song talks about a future that you can imagine as being true. And I think the best verse in the Bible on faith and how we do it is really all about imagination. That's in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. I'm going to read a couple of extra verses with it. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Faith shows the reality of what we hope for. It is the evidence of things we cannot see. Through their faith, the people in days of old earned a good reputation. By faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command. And what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. Or in the New King James Version, faith is the substance, or the Greek word hypostasis, of anticipated things, and the conviction, which is the Greek word elongos, about things not visible. Or the Common English Bible goes, faith is the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we don't see. In the NIV, now faith is the confidence of what we hope for, the assurance hoped for. The New Revised Standard, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Do you hear all these words? Reality, conviction, assurance, all for something that's anticipated, but not seen. That's what faith is. That's what it is to have faith. It's not psychological certainty. It's not talking yourself into something that you don't really believe. It's imagining a future that you anticipate. And that anticipation produces a conviction that it will be so, even though you do not yet see it. And that tends to orient you in a certain way, and it moves you in a certain direction, a move forward. And that's how faith becomes tangible. That's how it's seen. It's seen in the way that we live. It's seen in the way we act, in the ways we move into this future that we imagine to be so. We've been talking about faith and doubt this winter, and we're learning some things about doubt, how it is a necessary part of our faith journey, and that it can actually be a building block to make our faith stronger. We've discovered that faith isn't a matter of talking yourself into believing something you can't, that it's a covenant, an agreement of trust with another, even when there's no certainty of that. But let's get back. What does it mean to have faith, a Christ-centered faith, when you face an impossible situation, a situation so extremely difficult as to be unfixable? What does imagination have to do with that? What is it like to imagine a future beyond that particular situation? A lot of us are thinking, well, I'm in that kind of situation right now. I mean, this pandemic, it's killing us, and I mean that in more ways than one. I just saw an article reminding us how Ash Wednesday is a day to be reminded of our own mortality and penitence. But haven't we been doing that already? Diana Butler Bass was writing, "For more than a year now, that's been pretty much all I've done. Reflect, pray, and read, mostly alone, all the while worried that I might die, or that someone I love might die, or I'd unwittingly contribute by my own carelessness to someone else dying. Every time I put on a mask, I think of death and dying. In a year of a 500,000 deaths of other Americans and millions of people around the world, the Lenten discipline of contemplating mortality seems like one more painful day. We don't need ashes to remind us that the world is heavy with sorrow and that much of what we love is being lost and is ending." Wow. There's a scene in a movie that's set back in the Vietnam era, and there are a couple of teachers that are standing at the back of a crowd next to an open grave as the military honors are being completed for a former student of theirs. And one of them says to the other, "We know too many of these kids." I feel that a lot of times as I hear the reports of someone else or someone that I've known who we've lost. Our family and our friends and we ourselves, well, we go through depression and frustration and anger. And going through that, we experience a kind of grief. And it's not a one-time thing. We have to constantly reset our expectations to come to grips with the reality that we know. And we have to let go of certain things that we thought were settled. We try to acclimate, but the ground keeps shifting, and the reality is you just can't fix it. You know, it's something that you want so badly to happen, and you just can't make it happen. But I can imagine it. I can believe because I can visualize it. You know, those loved ones who are in the grips of COVID, who are struggling with all that comes with it, we have to imagine a life beyond that. I know that some people are really imagining what it will be like when we're no longer in quarantine. And we have to imagine what it'll be like to have some of those friends back with us, to be present with them. But you know, for some of them, it will have to wait for the next life. And even if some of the victories that we wait for are in the next life, well, you know what? I can imagine that too. But first, we've got to face the facts that we can't fix the world. But We can't fix it, but maybe we can make a difference. We have to learn to live in that odd balance, not fix, but make a difference. So what does faith look like in that kind of situation? I think it looks a lot like imagination. So what does it mean to imagine a Christ-centered fix, a Christ-centered future in an unfixable situation? Well, I mean, could be a situation with your family, with your kids. Maybe it's a relationship that's not fixable, or something at work that's not fixable, or in your church that's unfixable. Maybe it's in society itself. It could be your health, and maybe that's not going to get better. You know, COPD doesn't ever go away. Cancer doesn't go away on itself, and maybe not ever. Alzheimer's doesn't clear up, and COVID only clears up some of the time. So how do you keep faith in a broken, dumb world? How do you keep walking in love and in gentleness and in hope? How do you keep blessing people? How do you stay optimistic when all the while you got to be realistic as well? Realistic about how unfixable our world is. I think it's really about the story that you live in. What sort of future can you imagine? The writer of Hebrews here tells us that faith is what you can concretely imagine and what you anticipate to the point that you begin to experience a conviction that it is so, even though you don't see it yet. Maybe all the evidence is even against it, but there is a confidence about the world that you are imagining. Now, John Lennon had faith. It was a story that he imagined. And in this song, he's encouraging us to live that story too. It gave him hope. Hope of a world where there would be no more wars or no more possessions or countries or no more greed, all of that. And you know, there are echoes of the kingdom of God in that dream. And he's saying to us, can you imagine that? I wonder if you can. I mean, I think his faith is headed in the right direction, but I don't think he goes far enough. You see, his story, his dream, which is a dream of so many, the thing is, it doesn't really work unless you accept that there is a God, the kind of God who can create dreamers and who aren't satisfied with the way that things are. Those dreamers, they don't occur, they don't happen on their own. And without God, it's hard to imagine that human beings will ever beat our addiction to violence or outgrow our need for racial and economic and ideological hierarchies. Nor does his story actually leave a lot of room for eternity. Whatever peace we get is temporary. For right now, it's here and gone in an instant. Here's another story that I think is more appealing, more compelling, and even more believable. In this story, we, all of us human beings, are created in the image of a personal God. And the reason that we have a mind, well, it's because we're created by one who has a mind. And the reason that we have morals, it's because that we are created in the image of a moral being. The reason we long for purpose is because we're made in the image of a purposeful being. God created us to share himself with us in all of his wonder, and God created us for us to share in the responsibility for a little slice of the cosmos and to take care of this little plot of creation and to celebrate and to enjoy our existence with God as we share God's rulership over all the earth. But in this story, the gospel story, we and other spiritual agents rebelled. And the reason the cosmos is so messed up is, and the reason that Earth is so messed up, and the reason that we're so messed up is because of this rebellion against the Creator. Now we have a way of explaining why we have this need for countries and religions and greed and racism and wars. And now we have a reason to understand that we are so addicted to violence because we're messed up. We're not the way we're supposed to be. And it explains why we're so unhappy with the way that the world is now. Why we dream these dreams. It's because we are meant for something better than this. We can imagine it. Our imagination, it's something that is like, it's echoes of eternity. Echoes of the life that God created us to live. We messed up, but according to the gospel story, according to the kingdom story, God didn't give up on us. This God of unfathomable love became one of us and died for us. And that explosion of love that happened on Calvary defeated the spiritual forces that were against us. That explosion of love reconciled us to God and restored us to a rightful position on this planet. And so according to that story, it's just a matter of time until the whole cosmos acknowledges the truth that Jesus Christ is the Lord and the King and the ruler. And according to this story, God's perfect love will reign forever. I mean, Paul puts this like this in Ephesians. Ephesians 1, he's talking about the wonderful plan. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. You see, that's the purpose. He's got this plan to bring all things together in unity. The mystery of God's will is that. And so, we're invited to choose. We all live in a story. You just need to choose which one. Is it going to be, well, Lenin's story? Is it going to be God's story? Is it going to be some other story that we embrace? I trust that this one is the true story. And when you consider all the historical evidence and the psychological evidence, the existential and philosophical evidence, well, I think I've got every reason to believe that it is true. Yeah. Now, at the end of this story, like at the end of John Lennon's story, there are no more countries or religion. There's no more killing or dying. There's no more greed. There's no more poverty. All of that's great. But at the end of this story, there is also no more sickness and no more death and no more cancer or COVID or broken bodies and other things that afflict us. There's also no more evil or destruction, no more rebellion, no more violence or injustice. In this story, death doesn't have the last word. God does. Life does. Evil doesn't have the last word. Goodness does. Darkness doesn't have the last word. Light does. Hatred doesn't. God's love does. So the question is, can you imagine such a story? When we're facing an unfixable situation, can we imagine waiting for this fulfillment of the time to come? Faith is the substance of anticipated things, the conviction that things that are not yet visible. You know, there is a coming time when God's perfect love will define the cosmos. Can we imagine that? It will give us strength to press on even if we don't yet see it. That's what imagination will do. When the evidence seems to be against it and the world doesn't look like it's moving in that direction, when we can't fix the situation, we can still imagine a future when it's all integrated into the victory of Jesus Christ. It means that we can keep on loving. It means that we can keep on learning. Oh, we can keep on looking for a solution, but you know, we can have peace even before we find it. You see, we don't live in a story that says this is all there is. Imagine the story that the gospel invites us to imagine. And let's live in that story. The story where Christ is victorious, where everything will be brought to unity under the lordship, under the rulership of Jesus Christ. Can we live that story? Can we envision that story? Can we have faith in that story and imagine that story? That's how to live faithfully. I'm going to end just with a little exercise that I saw this. I learned this exercise from John Ortberg, the pastor out in California. We close our eyes and we ask God to show us in our minds just one unfixable thing in your life right now. Something that you wish you could fix, but you can't. And so hold it in your hands. Hold your hands out and then let it go. Let go of the urge to fix it. Open up your hands and just let it go. Yeah, you can still pray about it. You can still think of ways to do something about it, but let's give the results to God. Imagine that Jesus has the situation to this issue in hand, and let's give it to him. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that we can trust you. Thank you for the gift of imagination. Oh, we don't use it often enough, Lord, but help us to use our imaginations to imagine your kingdom come here on earth. And let that guide us, guide our steps, our vision of this world in terms of the world to come. Thank you, God, that we have you to guide us for this. Amen.
Let's join together in singing that great old hymn, number 144 in the United Methodist Hymnal, but you can look at the words right on the screen. This is my Father's world. That song, that's a great song. When you get discouraged, when you feel uncertain, sing that song to yourself in your head and who knows, maybe even sing it out loud. You'll get the attention of all kinds of people around you. It's a great prayer of renewal and of hope. Speaking of prayers, I want us to join together to give a prayer of thanksgiving and blessing on all the gifts that our church here, Osceola United Methodist, has received to help us continue to do our work and the work of the kingdom. And we continue to pray that we are being responsive to God, and we continue to pray thanksgiving for all of you who support that ministry. Not only support it, I challenge you, I ask you, I covet your feedback and your response, and hold us accountable in what we're doing for God's kingdom in our community. Will you? It's your job, because you're making wonderful gifts to us to keep us going. So continue giving and continuing to challenge us to be responsive to that. So why don't we offer together a prayer of dedication for all of our gifts? Lord God, you share your glory with us, giving us comfort and hope in your Son, Jesus Christ. In gratitude and thanks, we offer our hearts, our lives, and all that we have to you. May our offerings be an answer to your call to free the trapped, heal the broken, and show your good news to the poor and hopeless. Bless our lives, that we may shine with your glory and light up the world with your love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. There are a few things that are going on this week that I invite you to join us for, a few things in our church fellowship. You will be able to see a number of those things in the weekly link that we sent out this week by email or by snail mail. If you haven't gotten one, give a call and request it, or email us and ask for us to send it out to you. Just a couple of things I want to lift up there for this week. We are having a couple of careful in-person meetings, sort of in-person. On Wednesday at 1 o'clock, there is a Parables from the Backside study. That's at 1 o'clock on Wednesday. We're meeting in our fellowship hall, safely distanced and wearing masks, and we're having a discussion on Jesus' favorite stories. That same evening, Wednesday, February 24th at 7 o'clock, invite you to go online and find our podcast. It will be on our Facebook page, or will be on our YouTube channel. And our podcast, as we are looking at the world's most dangerous prayer. That's right. This week we're talking, the title is Kingdom Come. And we're talking about our request that God's kingdom will come down on earth in the Lord's Prayer. We're having that podcast at 7 o'clock. And then at 7:30, there will be a Zoom discussion and feedback and follow-up on that. And so if you should receive your invitation to that Zoom gathering in an email coming out in a little bit this week. And so we're in Matthew 6, verse 10. May your kingdom come on earth. And then invite you to join us again for the podcast on our February 28th service. And we're going to talk about God's plan. Today we talked a little bit about the hope that we have. We can imagine a future. We're going to talk about what God's plan is for the future next week. So invite you to that. In the newsletter, you will find some things about the activities of Lent. I want to lift up to you our Lenten prayer, our Giving from Abundance calendar. And you should have received that in your packet, or you can receive that online. I can email, in fact, I will email out, I will attach that to an email, I'm sending it out to everyone. It's already a few days into Lent, we started on Wednesday, and so you can play catch up in that, but it's a fun way to collect some items. It gets us thinking about how much we have and how much other people have needs. And this will be a fun way to reflect on that. And then we're responding to some of those who have needs. Our Lenten offering is going to two different places. One of them is local, and we are sharing with interfaith caregivers of Polk County, those folks who help with all kinds, have volunteers that help out with rides and medical visits and store visits and all kinds of other things. So we're going to be supporting them. And then our other one is going international. And we are supporting the Mujila Falls Agricultural Center in Zambia, which is a part of our General Board of Global Missions. You can find all of the details about this in our newsletter. We'll explain a little bit more, but use our Lenten Giving from Abundance calendar to help you make a collection for that. I think those are the announcements I want to share. So let us just end our service, our time together, with this benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, may the love of God, our eternal Father, and may the Holy Spirit, our comfort, guide, be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace" in response. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. And where only life. Where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. And in the name of the resurrected Christ, all God's people said, Amen. God bless you this week, folks.